So I think, sir, we can now move on to the next session.
That's right. The next talk is to be moderated by Mayank Tiwari. Now, Mayank Tiwari certainly needs no introduction. Perhaps the most visible face we have on this conference is that of Mayank Tiwari. Therefore, I don't need to introduce him. But for those who may have tuned in late and are in only now, I would like to mention that Mayank Tiwari is one of the founder members of the Rail Enthusiast Society. In fact, he is into so many aspects of the Rail Enthusiast Society that perhaps the society may collapse without him. He is a professional railwayman in his normal life, but totally involved in the Rail Enthusiast Society and its activities. In fact, he was the one who introduced me to rail enthusiasm. I was always, it was always in me, but meeting other rail enthusiasts. For that, I can give credit to Mayank Tiwari. So therefore, I would like to hand over to Mayank Tiwari to start the next session. Over to you, Mayank.
Thank you very much, JL Singh, sir. I think you've been exceedingly kind and more generous than is merited. But I think that has always been your way. And that's what motivates us to keep going. My real pleasure today lies, before I do move on, somebody is sharing the screen. Can I request that you please do not do that? Yeah, thank you so much. That is really kind of you. So to begin the next session of the day, it is my absolute pleasure, privilege and joy to introduce to you Mr. Tarun Thakral, a man who needs no introduction amongst any rail enthusiast of any kind in this country or abroad. But Tarun, I would do a disservice if I were not to briefly cover some of your achievements, which are, I think, just a precursor to the many, many more that will follow. Professionally, Tarun is synonymous with Le Méridien. Hospitality is his line of work, his chosen profession and his area of excellence. And yet Tarun is also a very, very keen hobbyist. Vintage cars, transportation, that's what drives Tarun quite literally at times. And persistence and a desire to share his hobby with the larger canvas of India and the world is what prompted Tarun to form the Heritage Trust way back in 1996, where he saw a dream to create in India a museum as a private individual. Now, that is extremely difficult to do and rare to do in India. And I had the good fortune to actually meet Tarun while the museum was still in the thinking phase and on the design phase, and when he was wondering how to raise funds for it. But it is a compliment to Tarun that on 7th of December 2013, he threw open the Heritage Transportation Museum to the world. And as early as 2016, just 3 years into existence, that museum has been receiving rave reviews from everyone in India and abroad, and is already the winner of many, many awards. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Mr. Tarun Thakral. Tarun, the stage is all yours. You would need to unmute yourself, Tarun, and then we'd love to hear from you.
Thank you, Mayank. That was indeed, it's always wonderful listening to you, but for the first time I'm hearing you giving me compliments, and I think that's a double-edged, it's a benefit from multiple angles, especially coming from a person like you. I'd also like to thank the Railway Enthusiast Society for inviting me to share my experiences of the Heritage Transport Museum. You know, while I'm talking to you right now, behind my back, our steam engine is actually functioning. I'm talking to you from the Heritage Transport Museum, and let me just quickly show you guys before. Mayank, you'll have to do the recorded presentation because I wouldn't be able to hear very clearly. But I'm actually just going to show you just for a moment.
So Tarun did warn us that he's going to be at the museum. It might just be very noisy. So we have a backup presentation. But before that, please do enjoy the museum itself.
Can you guys see it? Ma'am, can you...
Oh, absolutely.
Yeah, yeah, we can see.
There she is and she's on steam. My God, Tarun, that's really wonderful.
Can you see it moving?
Oh, yes, absolutely. Did you do this specially for us? Or is this something that
you
do? It's
part of... On rare occasions, we actually steam it up and fire it up for the benefit of visitors. And there she is.
What a remarkable start to this session, Tarun. Thank you so much. I think for steam fans the world over, this is a great way to start your talk.
Mayank, Tarun, I'll leave. I'm so sorry, but I'll rejoin you in about 20 minutes. Hopefully by the time the pre-recorded version is over, where all your viewers will get a chance to experience the Heritage Transport Museum.
Absolutely wonderful, Tarun. Thank you so much for that great start. And what we are going to do now is we'll just move into a recorded presentation, and Tarun will join us for live questions and answers just after that. Apurva, may I please request that we upload and run Tarun's presentation.
Can you see the screen?
Yeah, we see the screen. We are not able to hear.
Okay.
Namaste. Good morning. Good
yes, we hear him now.
Good evening.
Okay. Can we go full screen on this?
For introducing me, and also the Rail Enthusiast Society for inviting me over to talk to all of you, wherever you are in whichever part of the world, to listen to this story of the Heritage Transport Museum, which is India's first comprehensive transport museum. In India, as all of you may be aware, 99% of the museums are owned and operated by the government of India or the state governments in the respective states. This was an initiative way back after I had collected various items and objects pertaining to transportation of India and didn't know what to do with it. So then I decided, okay, let me make a museum. And on my various travels world over, I found that private individuals and trusts and societies do have a lot of museums. There are a lot of museums everywhere. But in India, unfortunately, it was the domain of the governments. And for some reason or the other, they had not evolved over time. So we decided that let us create a museum, which is something different, which is visitor-centric, in which the focus of the museum are the visitors. And that's been the success of our museum as an individual trust that we are so proud of today, that even after 7 years, people continue to throng to our museum. And we have proven beyond imagination that museums can be successful in India. Mind you, the culture of going to museums had died down over a period of time because unfortunately Indian museums had not changed over a period of time. And that was our biggest objective when we planned our trust and when we planned our museum. I'm not going to talk too much, but I'm going to take you to a short film which will talk about, or which will give you a glimpse, actually. It's a 2-minute film, so don't get bored, of the museum. Have a look at it. Thank you. All right. So what did we do? You know, I was out of the country for a few years, and I decided that when I came back, I suddenly got fond of old transportation objects. And I actually didn't know what to do. And this was way back in 1994. And suddenly my collection grew to that extent that I actually had difficulties maintaining it because it was taking a lot of my money. And also I needed larger spaces to keep these large objects. So I formed the trust, a not-for-profit trust in 2006, with the primary object of creating a museum sometimes in the future. And in India, whenever you talk to people that, or whenever I had talked to people that, okay, you want to, that I wanted to make a museum, people thought that I've gone a little crazy because nobody in India makes museums. Museums have been the domain of the governments, of the state. It's not people in India. People in India invest land or money into commercial projects where they can make money. I had different plans. I thought that India needed a comprehensive transport museum. There was nothing like this in India. And there were railways had their domain in making rail museums. Indian Air Force had their domain in making Air Force museums. Private erstwhile Maharajas had a little bit of transportation in their state museums or their erstwhile collections from what they had acquired over a period of time. So we formed the trust in 2006. We were fortunate to receive a grant from the government of India. But eventually the cost, the grant amount was very little to what we had envisaged. We had envisaged a modern building with being completely visitor-centric and modern. We wanted to change the exhibits after a couple of months so that there is something new for every visitor every time they visit us. And I'm very fortunate, rather my team and I were very fortunate that right from the inception, right from the day of the opening of the museum, we've had a tremendous amount of footfalls, which actually have, you know, gives us that much of pride as well as that energy to keep acquiring newer exhibits, to keep doing something new, again, which are focused on transport that have existed in India through the years. We are a decent sized space. We are a building spread over 3 acres with a built up area of 100,000 square feet. And we have 3.5 acres of gardens, open gardens to, you know, allow people to move around with comfort and leisure. Some of the larger exhibits of the museum, like the steam engines, have been placed in the open because we actually run them. We actually are proud that we are the only private institution in India which has a working locomotive, you know, which we have laid a track of about 100 feet. Some of the, I mean, the museum is divided into various galleries. The pre-mechanized modes of transport, railways, heavy mechanized, automobiles, the discovery section. And we've also mixed contemporary art within the museum, which makes it very interesting for every, for person of every, you know, for every person who, you know, whether it's a male, female, a child, an adult, an elderly person. Our popular exhibits include a bird cart from the Indus Valley Civilization, which actually denotes that the wheel existed in India. The primary mode of movement, the wheel, existed in India during the Indus Valley civilization, and that's the starting point of the museum. We have the only Indian flag that has traveled to the moon and back. It went on the Apollo 15 mission, and we were fortunate to win it in an auction a couple of years back, and which is proudly displayed at the museum. Another very interesting element is the Bollywood, you know, or the Indian cinema, which everybody connects to. And there also we have a couple of vehicles which have actually taken part in the movies, and they're also there at the museum. When we had envisaged the museum, our primary goal was that the museum should be self-sustainable. It should have that much of revenue streams that besides the entry tickets, we should be able to host events which will give us more money to actually be able to sustain without any donations or without any, you know, contributions from individuals. And I think we've been pretty successful in that. Because in India, this was an untested model. I mean, I'm not going into the business aspect of it, but when you look at it, museums world over have constant grants coming from various societies, various government agencies. In India, we don't have any such societies which offer you grants. The government museums are fortunate that they get grants from the government authorities, whereas we had received just a one-time grant, and to operate, the government was very clear that you'll have to sustain it yourself, and at least for a minimum period of 33 years. So while we built the museum, we were very certain that we had to build revenue sources. So our seminar rooms or even the outdoor gardens which we use for events have come in very handy. We've been a host to various domestic and international tourists. It's actually become a very popular spot for all tourists traveling between Delhi to Jaipur, because we are located slightly off the city limits of Delhi, but yet close enough for people to actually come and spend a day out. Yes, public transportation still is an issue, so people do come in with their own private vehicles or public transport, but then they have to change multiple buses to reach the museum. Our biggest success has been schools, which virtually all the schools of Delhi, Gurgaon, and adjoining areas have actually visited, and they keep visiting every year. Pre-COVID, we actually, every day there used to be a school group visiting us. Besides, of course, the tourist groups, weekends have been reserved for families, so that families can come and enjoy with their parents or their grandparents. Some of the visitor reactions, I mean, it's all over the internet. Everybody can see it. Everybody can go through it. These are some of the ones which are just picked up randomly. They're available on TripAdvisor, Facebook, etc. During the course of the last 7 years, we've actually received multiple awards. And thanks to our visitors, actually, that we have been able to prove to not only the visitors, but also to the government authorities that, yes, private museums are successful and can be successful in India also. Extensive media coverage, both print media as well as electronic, and that's how we have been able to reach across audiences all over India and abroad, has been through the print. And we really thank them for, you know, believing in us and actually thinking that we have been, you know, we are a unique kind of a destination for anybody to visit. Let me come back especially to railways, okay? Because we are a part of the railway enthusiast society, and especially talking today about the railway collection that we have here at the museum. It's difficult to acquire objects in India. Nothing is available readily. You have to hunt for them. You have to source them. Excuse me. You have to try and, you know, have your people on the ground trying to find out what is available where. And on top of that, trying to convince the railway board that, you know, please, please, please hand it over to hand. We would like to have this object, or hand it over to us, rather than, you know, getting it destroyed or selling it on scrap. Mind you, in 2003, my first railway object was the 1930s railway saloon, which was built by Sheffield and Company way back in 1930s, which was adapted for the Palace on Wheels when it started. It was a meter gauge saloon lying in a dilapidated condition at Ajmer Carriage Workshops. And I thought, let me just get it. At that time, the museum in 2003, I had no, it was not a thought, but it was just like I could have it at my place, my small place, you know, in Gurgaon at that time. But over the years since then, that actually gave a kickstart to my collection of railways. And as you can see, that today we have a decent collection of railway items. And I'm going to show you, you know, in the next slides as to what we got and how they are today. This is a Kerr-Stewart locomotive from 1921, the condition when we procured it, and its condition after restoration. There's still a couple of parts missing, and that's why it's not functional at the moment, but we are in the process of acquiring those parts and getting it functional very soon. This is the Bagnell locomotive of 1924. Again, was in a dilapidated condition when we saw it, and today we have restored it for it to run. The Jung locomotive, which again is in a fully functional state, and we are very proud that we are one of the few institutions which has a fully functional locomotive. Besides locomotives, we also acquired a rail bus, a narrow gauge rail bus from Katwa Junction. And this is a very popular object for the visitors who've never seen a rail bus in operation or have never heard about a rail bus also. this is one of our prized collections, a 1940s wood-bodied tram, which used to run in Calcutta, or Kolkata as they call it now. A difficult restoration project, but eventually it's all there. Unfortunately, we can't run it, but it's there. People can walk in and experience. We have movies, we have televisions inside, which allow people to experience as though they are sitting in a tram and actually going through the cities of Calcutta. Plus, of course, the history of tramways all over India. This is the 1930s railway saloon, which we have acquired and actually placed within the inside the museum on a recreated railway station. The recreated railway station has an old railway clock. It has old railway lamps. It has got a showcase which depicts various models of railways that were used in India. It has an old ticketing cabinet. It has old railway posters and also enamel signs that were typical of those eras when enamel signs were made, enamel advertising signs were made and were displayed on various railway stations. Some of the other railway objects, which includes a water column, railway inspection trolley, a Meriwether, a fire pump, a mechanical level crossing also. We've got the complete functional level crossing. That's very difficult for us to convince the railways also that we need these items because we want to enhance our collection of the railways. It's and for railways also it's difficult that what are these guys going to do with it? Because there is no other institution like the Heritage Transport Museum which has tried to acquire things and try to make it, you know, present it to the visitors. You know, big objects or large objects like these or what we've seen just now are different. But I personally think there's a lot more to railways than these things. Look at the old photographs. We have a huge collection of old original photographs of railways of India, right from, you know, the old prints to albumen photographs from a time which has gone by. And I mean, it's just fun looking at these photographs, looking at postcards and philately, which has appeared over railways, the old railway stations. I mean, you can never get this, even if you don't have a photograph of it. The only other way was to find it in a postcard. And we have a huge collection. These are just sample random pictures that I've shortlisted for today's presentation. There are collectors in India, there are collectors world over who collect specific railway stuff. And I think all of you must be aware as rail fans or as enthusiasts, these actually present a picture of India and Indian railways in a very beautiful way, in a way which we can't imagine what it was, you know, during those times. Look at these promotional posters. I mean, I personally think that railways at those times were actually doing a lot of advertising, whether it was the BBCI railway, whether it was GIP, whether it was Eastern Railway. Every private railway prior to their becoming nationalized had artists, renowned artists, who used to come and draw their posters. And then they used to print it in bulk and put it everywhere so that people could use their, you know, railway services to travel from one place to the other. These are very rare today. And we are fortunate that we have a collection of, a large collection of original railway posters, which I don't think anybody else has it in India. Look at the graphics, look at, these are, were all hand-drawn. These are all from the 30s, 1930s, and almost about 80, 90 year old. The other very interesting element of Indian railways has been the Indian movies or the Bollywood. We're very fortunate that the museum has a huge connection, collection of Bollywood posters and lobby cards. Again, these are very raw, very rare. We recently had an exhibition of the Bollywood connect with transportation. And not only did we have the railway posters, we also had posters pertaining to vehicles. We had posters pertaining to two-wheelers. Now, the reason why, you know, these posters, we have a collection of these posters, it's again nostalgia. It's also that particular rail engine or the railways, the theme of that movie was so strong that it actually came out in the promotional poster of the railways, given, you know, that it was that important. We've all heard beautiful songs that have been depicted on Indian railways, which has been shot in a railway carriage. or Aradhana, for that matter, that beautiful song where Rajesh Khanna sings besides the railway, the Darjeeling train going on. I mean, these things bring nostalgia to visitors. These things are a connect with our past. Not only the museum, you know, today, as we stand after almost about 7.5 years, the success of the museum primarily has been that people have been able to connect with it. And that's very important because we can have artifacts of various nature within the museum. And if the visitor is unable to connect with it in any form, the museum is not going to be a success. Any museum today, you know, and the West does it very well, they are able to connect with its visitors. Unfortunately, in India, our museums have failed to connect with their visitors because their focus has been on objects, whereas the Heritage Transport Museum's focus has been the visitors. That's been a success. And I'm sure that the railways today, there are many museums which the railways are trying to build and are coming up. The National Rail Museum has so many beautiful objects. I'm sure that all of us agree that it's one of the most beautiful museums that is there in our country with beautiful objects. But the main thing is that how do we promote it to a greater extent where we have more visitors coming there? How do we evolve it to so that today's generations can also enjoy it? And I think at the end of the day, unless central museums learn to evolve continuously, to the generations that we are targeting, and that too, especially the younger generation, I don't think we can actually be a success. We have to keep up with the times, and I'm sure success will be ours. And I mean, that's what I wanted to talk about, give you a glimpse of our collections and give you, the nature of our museum. It's been difficult to start the museum, but eventually I think it's been a success. And thank you all for listening to me and bearing with me for all this, 25 minutes or so. And we're happy to, receive any questions. Mayank, I think it's your call now. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Tarun. An absolutely stunning presentation. Hats off to you. Before we actually go ahead, I think it's only fair that I should read out a few of the comments that have landed here. Amazing ones over here. Alexander Khan's a very personal message for you. It was a fitting start. It was a fitting starting kick to see the young locomotive and steam outside. Thank you again for arranging my stay in 2018 to assist with the steam locomotive effort in Rewari and Chakurbasti. Your museum is still inspiring and you continue to do a fantastic job. Clearly, not only are you creating a great museum, you're supporting rail enthusiasts in a huge way. I think inspired by what you've achieved in the museum, Sagar Tipnis has to say, I hope the museum gets one of the iconic best BEST double deckers, since BEST has recently withdrawn a big bunch for scrap as they completed their caudal life. BEST and the government of Maharashtra have no inclination on preserving them for posterity. A quick reaction to that one, Tarun?
He needs to unmute himself.
Tarun, if you could just unmute yourself, we are good to go.
All right. We got to know about 6 months back, and we've written a letter to BEST, and we are constantly following it up with BEST for the double deckers. In fact, we had requested that if not two, at least one of them should be given to the museum, but we are still awaiting. There's a lot of bureaucracy in these things, and we are trying through various sources that they do you know, gave us one, at least one of them, if not two.
Wonderful, wonderful. That is absolutely great, because I think increasingly now people are seeing you as a savior of preserving the transportation heritage for the country. Mr. T.R. Raghunandan has two remarks spaced apart. The first one, where he actually says, can never tire of watching presentations of the Heritage Transport Museum, a real tour de force. And he follows that up a little later by saying, Heritage Transport Museum should set up museums elsewhere too. Please come to Bangalore. We could make an interesting offer to you.
Oh, Mayank, we are actually in talks with a couple of organizations. One is the Chandigarh Union Territory to open an automotive museum there. In fact, as late as yesterday, we had an official coming in from the Ajmer, from Ajmer, where they are planning to build a museum, a rail museum, and they had come to have a look at our museum and wanted us to visit them and guide them as to how do they present the Rail Museum of Ajmer. We are also in talks, and I think, you know, Raghu, I know Raghu very well, and he's a dear friend. The amazing work that he is doing, I think we could all join hands and actually create something, whether it's for Bangalore or any other place. I think it'll be worthwhile. You need enthusiasts, you need people with a little bit of passion, and there are many people, like we've seen it in this museum, people come forward on their own, both to assist financially, as well as to, you know, keep forcing you that, okay, keep going. There are many positive people around. And the more you try and inspire people, I think at the end of the day, museum's role is to inspire people. And if we are able to inspire even a handful of them, I think we'll be in our country will be in a different league tomorrow.
Well, all I can say is, knowing Raghu and knowing you, Tarun, anything that the two of you are going to do together is going to be something to really look out for.
Thanks.
Atulya Sinha says, I have put Heritage Transport Museum on the list of places I must visit soon. And then he follows that up with a remark when he says, are any events being organized by Heritage Transport Museum? Events can increase the involvement of visitors and bring them back again and again. Now, I know you do a lot of this, but I'm going to go ahead and let you share that with the audience.
You know, we're actually having an event today. We have close to about 45 vintage cars which have driven from Delhi to the museum, and about 10 vintage scooters. And there are almost about 150 in number who are actually here spending the entire day. It's called the Day at the Museum by the Heritage Motoring Club of India. So they're here at the moment as I'm talking to you. And we do have events spread through the year. Predominantly, they're targeted towards the residents of Delhi and Gurgaon, because that's where we receive the major footfalls. And our events are basically visitor-centric. So during, you know, special festivities, for example, the Independence Day weekend, we actually run Independence Day weekend activities for 3 days, not just for the Independence Day. Similarly, the public day. Similarly, whenever there are holidays associated with the weekend, we actually run our events for those 3 or 4 days together. As a result, if you can't make it on one particular day, you always have the option of coming the next day. Not, you know, what I had showed you in the museum was the museum per se. We have 3.5 acres of garden with the museum. Now, we use a lot of those garden spaces for outdoor activities. As a result, once visitors have seen the museum, they can always go and partake and enjoy in the beautiful outdoors, you know, the activities. So that's the reason. And the biggest success of our museum has been word of mouth. Unfortunately, we don't have that kind of money to put print ads or, you know, talk about it on the radio. But the success of our museum has been, and it continues to be, word of mouth. Anybody who comes here goes and tells 20 other people, and then you talk to them at the reception when they arrive. They always say that so-and-so had come here and they, you know, talked about it. So, I mean, events are a part of us. We do a lot of them.
What a remarkable compliment to you to have repeat visitors and to have word of mouth people. In fact, your presentation today has spoken so eloquently that Mr. YB Sharma asks, any thoughts about a government railway museum being taken over by a trust such as yours?
I had sent a proposal to Ministry of Culture, not to Ministry of Railways, that unfortunately, Indian museums need a sea change focus because our focus, even till today, is not visitor-centric. We need to change this if the museums are supposed to be successful. You know what has happened, Mayank, over a period of time, the culture of going to museums has died down in India. You really have to force people to visit an Indian museum, whereas when you compare it to certain Western museums, people automatically want to go there. We as Indians, whenever we visit that city, we want to go there. Indian tourism department necessarily does not promote our museums. So it's for us as operators of museums or as managers of museums to create awareness and also make sure that the place is exciting. If today's generation needs technology in museums, because they are not used to reading, you know, lengthy quotes given besides an object, they don't have that patience. How can we improve that? How can we, you know, create or give them that, you know, sense that, okay, they can belong here also, the younger generation. And how to make the whole museum space very exciting, whether you want to, you know, there are many ways of doing it. And yes, I mean, we keep talking to railway officials from time to time, but nothing concrete has come out as yet because there are various, I mean, the idea is there that, okay, there should be a PPP model for museum, but nothing has come out in paper. Nothing has actually got signed. We were very actively involved with when the project of Mumbai CS70 railway station was being decided to partly be converted into a museum. We went and did a couple of presentations to the authorities. They were very happy with our presentation and the kind of work that we had done. But again, that program was shelved, so it's still not on. So that's what basically, we definitely want to go ahead also, but at the same time, nothing concrete has come up as yet.
Tarun, you've proven yourself to be a person of persistence and perseverance, so I'm sure this is also a path that you will shortly walk. In fact, your answer kind of dovetails into the next question that Mr. Sanjay Mukherjee has for you, where he says, Kolkata has just started Tram World. If Tarun can write to the West Bengal Transport Corporation, it will work to really make it world-class. The MD is very proactive and Mr. Mukherjee says that he can help to connect the two of you.
I'd love to. And I'll personally speak to Mr. Mukherjee later on today and try and connect with this because I do know that they have started the Tram World Museum. And I think a lot needs to be done there to make it a world-class museum.
Absolutely marvelous. And we'll help you make the connection because Mr. Sanjay Mukherjee is a very active member and he heads the Calcutta chapter of the RES. So it'll be great to connect the two of you. I spot that we are reaching the end of the session and yet there are many questions. But as moderator, Tarun, allow me to ask you that one question I've been wanting to. See, this museum is obviously very, very close to your heart. And I know for a fact that you've been personally involved in the acquisition and curation of a lot of the collection that is seen there today. A slightly unfair question. Which one is your favorite collection there? And which one is it that tells the most interesting story?
I think from the museum's perspective, I mean, they're all my favorites. But the first one is always your... You know, you have a special love to your first child or, you know, your first baby in the museum. It's a 1932 Chevy car and the 1930 rail saloon, if you look at railways and automobiles, because those were my first. And I think, all that, whatever is here, I love equally all of them, and they're all going to remain here much after we are also gone, and hopefully the future generations will enjoy the thing that we have done. We added a little bit of a contribution to the society.
spoken like a very proud parent, Tarun. Thank you so very much. Tarun, we are out of time. I know the audience would love to hold on to you, but we are running out of time with this session. I'll only end off with a little thought. Maybe in a post-COVID world, when we are all duly vaccinated and safer, RES is proposing to do this conference every year. So I just hope that sooner rather than later, an RES annual conference gets hosted at your museum.
That'll be lovely. That'll be lovely. And indeed a pleasure.
On this very happy thought, thank you very, very much, Tarun, for making the time, because I know you've been rushing between events and you were very kind to reschedule and accommodate us. I am so glad that you were able to reach out through our platform as well. And more strength to you, Tarun. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Thanks. Thank you. Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
So we close out this wonderful session with Tarun Thakral now, and may I request Vikas Singh to please step in, because we had promised that the winners of the quiz for masters will be declared. So Vikas, I hand over to you now.
Yeah. So what I'm going to do is first declare the winners of the masters quiz. Then I'll quickly do a small quiz. I am going to ask you 3 questions today. It's the same format that we had done yesterday. The person who types in the chat the correct answer first wins. And at the end of the day, 3 winners get honorary membership to the society. Now, okay. We had 40 entries and there were 18 questions. So the first spot goes to Balasubramanian Ganesh. He got 17 questions right. Only the last question, which was about the unique gauge, one being the 4 feet and the other being 3 feet, 6 inches gauges, is the one where he went wrong. The second spot, we have 3 people vying for the second spot. Saurasangsha Maji with 16 points. Anirudh DSP with 16 points and Sagar Tipnis with 16 points. Now, all the 4 of them win honorary membership to the society for a year, as well as a copy of the publication, More Miles, More Smiles. Congratulations to all of you. We now quickly move to the quiz of the day. Okay. So the question is, which famous British mathematician is associated with Fontainebleau? His mother used to live there.
Vikas, will you also show the question on the screen?
I showed on the screen. It's not visible.
So yeah, the screen didn't change. We're still looking at the winners.
Oh, wait, I'll again share. Now, can you see the screen?
Yeah, it's there now. Thank you.
Okay. So the question is, which famous British mathematician is associated with Fontainebleau? Now, his mother used to live there. So I give a hint. His name starts with Alan, A-L-A-N. Can you complete his name? Yeah, Atulya got it right. It is Alan Turing. So Atulya got it right. Okay. The next question, this is an easier one, and I hope we get a lot of entries. Which small station is adjacent to Vijayawada Airport? Yeah, Atulya got it right. It is Gannavaram. So,
Vikas, can we just quickly check that everybody else is being able to type into the chat, because we had an issue earlier in the day? So in case somebody is not being able to type in the chat, just use your reactions and responses to raise your hand and we'll try to see you on gallery view and figure out.
Yeah. Okay. So we go to the next one.
I think we're good to go, Vikas. Yeah, shoot.
Okay. Which former British Transport Minister presented a BBC series on Indian Railways a few years ago? Yeah, Julian, can you type in the full name? Yes, it is correct. It is Portillo, but can you type in his first name, if it's possible? Okay. Yeah, it is Michael Portillo. So Julian got it right. We now have time for just one more question. Then we move on. Now, this is a fairly easy one. Where was the Railway Staff College set up in 1930s, long before it shifted to...
I think one minute. I think Michael Portillo, Warren had got it right before Julian.
No, but I don't see it in his chat.
In the chat, Warren has answered earlier.
Would Warren have accidentally sent you a private message? Because we are not spotting it on the chat.
Yeah.
Has he accidentally sent you a private message?
He has not sent a private message. It's on the chat itself.
We are unable to see.
So we are only seeing Julian, sir. We are not seeing Warren here at all, sir. Warren, could we request that you please change the setting to everyone and just put out a test message?
No, it is everyone. Everyone can do directly or to everyone.
No, correct, sir. But sir, other than you, none of us are being able to spot Warren's message. Ah, here he is. From Warren. Yes, Warren, we spot you now.
So, no, but I didn't see that. I think I still see Julian.
I still don't see it.
No?
Yeah, because I see only Julian.
So what you need to do perhaps, Vikas, is just keep Warren as a correct answer.
Yeah, right? Along with Julian. Yeah.
Yeah, along with Julian. So we'll have two people here.
Yeah.
Who have answered correctly.
Yeah. And Mr. R. Raghuram gave it right. It is Dehradun, where the college was set up before it being shifted to Vadodara. So we have four questions so far, and we have Atulya with two correct ones, and Julian, Warren, and R. Raghuram with one correct each.
Vikas, for those who may have joined in today, would you like to share the rules on how you will decide the winner for the quick quiz that we do at the end of every session?
Yeah, so that is what I said. So I'm going to ask a question, and the person who types in the correct answer first wins. At the end of the day, the top three who have typed in the correct answer first, the top three get honorary membership to the society for a year. Now that we are end of this question, now if we have time, we can either do a quick photo show or we can take the audience quickly through one of the Bollywood songs. So what would the audience want to see?
Vikas, why don't we do a Bollywood song now? So it'll give us a small, we have around 6-7 minutes. Would you like to run them through that?
Yeah, and that will just set the stage for Michael Whitehouse before he comes with his presentation. So I'll just quickly.
Perfect. Vikas, still no sound. Maybe if you stop the share and then when you start sharing again, just tick the box on the left for sharing the sound from your...
Just let me try once again.
No problem at all. Yeah,
can you see? Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
So we were talking about this train which was coming at us, and basically we spent maybe 20 minutes just having a snack and something. And then next second I looked up and we saw the two headlamps. Just prior to this, there were two gangmen who left the tunnel from our end and they started walking. And this all happened in a fraction of a second. And at my age and my size, I shouldn't be taking this risk, but I'm glad I took it because the train was coming at a fairly high speed. Now, what happens in the mouth of a Konkan Railway tunnel is that a train coming at high speed actually pushes the air away from you. So in a hot, muggy place, you feel great that a train is coming to you because the breeze has started to flow. But that is a signal that you should get out of the way. And by the time the train is right at the other end, it's absolutely a tornado of wind force which is coming to you. So that is the experience that we have here. This is one of the idyllic stations of Konkan Railways. It's called Ukshi. What you see is a train coming through a double line tunnel. This is the only double line tunnel in the whole of Konkan Railway. And you have a macaque monkey, which is like clearing away for the giant machine, which is coming its way. Ukshi is a station which is only 56 meters in height, but it takes a huge amount of mountains that you have to cross before reaching there. And it's just a small pathway, and you can't imagine that a train would pass through these parts, and suddenly the station is in front of you. Again,
Apurva, I'm really sorry, but yeah. I'm going to have to stop
okay,
you here.
Some other time, not a problem. Yeah. Okay, go ahead.
Thank you so much, and we'll pick up from Ukshi.
Sure.